We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we sing. Everyone sing. God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. We stand and lift up our joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. It is rising up all around. Is the anthem of the Lord's renown. It's rising up all around. Is the anthem of the Lord's renown. And together we sing. Everyone God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. Holy, holy.
Heavenly Father, You have taught us how to pray. And so, God, today we address you as Father, because we know you are the one who loves us, who cares for us, who has the warmth of a loving Father that we can come to in the place of prayer. And yet also we know that you are the God who is above all things. Holy be your name. God, we pray today that we would set aside our own desire for kingdom building, and we would pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God, we pray that our priorities would align with your priorities. And God, even today, as you challenge us from your word, may priorities be settled in our heart and mind so that we can become your disciples in a greater way. God, today our church has needs, and we personally have needs. And God, we pray that today, from your gracious hand, all provisions would be given. And God, that we would see that our daily bread and all other provisions needed for life come from your loving heart. And God, we confess today, God, we confess today that we are in need of you. God, even this week, even with our desire to follow you, we have misstepped, we have sinned against you. And God, we come today, God, all of us, in need of some level of confession. And so we pray, forgive us our debts. God, make us aware of our continual need for you. And then, God, we look around. God, others have hurt us in life. God, we, maybe some in this room, still bear the full scar of that hurt. And God, today I pray that by your strength, that you would allow us to grant forgiveness. That as you have forgiven us, may we forgive others. And then, God, we desire a smooth life. But God, we know smoothness is not always your situation for us. God, we pray. God, if you could allow us to avoid the time of the test, we would appreciate it. God, we don't desire to be thrown in the crucible of difficulty. And yet, God, if we find ourselves there, which we know they come, God, we pray, deliver us from the evil one. God, I pray today that our prayers would be informed by who you are and how you have taught us to pray. God, may this most central prayer not be a prayer that we forget, but may it be the priorities of prayer that we keep. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Each day I fall on my is still a mystery each day. I fall on my knees, 'cause your grace still amazes me. Your grace still amazes me.
Amen. Our prayers that people of God should be for God's kingdom to come on earth as it is in heaven. Let's stand together as we sing.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Come and let your glory, come and let your glory fall. Our Father, who art in heaven, the rocks cry out your name. So come and let your glory, come and let your glory fall. I will sing a new song. I will sing a new song. I will sing a new song to the Lord. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Every heart proclaims mercy of your name, on earth as it is in heaven. God, give us new every morning, mercy as daily bread. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, and lead us not in temptation, but deliver us with your hand. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus we pray. Father, we pray. I will sing a new song. I will sing a new song. I will sing a new song to the Lord. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Every heart proclaims the mercy of your name, on earth as it is in heaven. For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. Yeah, the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. Yeah, the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. Yeah, the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. Come, let your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Every heart proclaims the mercy of your name, on earth as it is in heaven. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Every heart proclaims the mercy of your name, on earth as it is in heaven.
to the Lord in prayer. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father, for your Son, Jesus Christ. And Father, we know it's early this morning, but we do just thank you for this time of worship that we're all willing to wake up and just praise you this morning, Lord. And there's no better place to be but in your house. Father, we come to this time in our worship service where we just give back a small portion of what you graciously bless us with, Father. And we just pray for this blessing and for the portion that goes to our North American missions, Father. We just ask that you have your hand on them and guide them and direct them just as you do us each and every day. And it's in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen.
Well, one of the basic questions that we have to ask as Christians is, how do we progress in our spiritual life? And one of the basic answers to that question, how do we progress in our spiritual life, has been engaging in spiritual disciplines. And spiritual disciplines are spiritual training or activities that are aimed at producing a specific character or pattern of behavior. Some spiritual disciplines are as follows: meditation on Scripture, prayer, fasting, charitable giving, Bible study, solitude, service, confession of sin, and corporate worship. These practices have been used certainly within Christianity, but actually, spiritual practices have been used all over the world for various purposes, for people to have an opportunity to get closer to God. Jesus today makes a turn in the Sermon on the Mount because he has been looking at how the commands of God have been distorted in a particular way, And Jesus, over the last several weeks, has taken the commands of God and put them back in their appropriate context and say, no, no, the commands of God, you've done this with them, but actually you're supposed to do that with them. And Jesus is getting to the heart. You know, some people look at me, and I'm not being judgmental. By the way, we'll address judgmentalism in a few weeks. But they look at me and they say, you know, I've been a Christian for 30 years. I've faithfully done this and faithfully done this. And they're just loaded up with sin patterns. And I almost want to look back at them and say, I don't think it's working. And so Jesus today actually says, you can engage in all manner of spiritual practices. And those practices not penetrate the heart. Worse yet, by the way, I am not at all today demeaning spiritual practices, because spiritual practices should, as Jesus shows us today, serve as a conduit through which we draw closer to God, in which we know Him more intimately. But we must keep ourselves in check, especially of those of us who are faithful churchgoers. It's early. We could just come and do church today, but not let it penetrate our heart. And every time we engage in a spiritual activity, we ought to be asking ourselves the question, is it working? Is it doing? Are we allowing it to do what God really wants it to do through us? Today, because you have decided to come to corporate worship, this ought to do something to you. It ought to convict your heart. It ought to encourage your soul. It ought to give you clarity for the moment. It ought to draw you closer to God. And if it's not, strangely enough, our sinful humanity can take those things which should be a conduit for goodness and turn them into an opportunity for evil. Only sinful humanity can take that which God intends to draw us closer to Him and turn it into something that is wholly inappropriate. If you have your Bible today, we have a longer text, but each one is so full of meaning. Matthew chapter 6, verse 1, we're going to read the first 18 verses. And then Jesus has one more bit to say about prayer in Matthew 7, 7 through 11. I'll read it all. Listen carefully. As Jesus addresses the misuse and then the proper use of spiritual practices. Verse 1, Matthew chapter 6. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of people, to be seen by them. Otherwise, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give to the poor, don't sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogue and on the streets to be applauded by people. I assure you, they've got their reward. But when you give to the poor, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Whenever you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, because they love to pray standing in the synagogue and on the street corners to be seen by people. I assure you, they've got their reward. But when you pray, go in your private room, shut your door, and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you pray, don't babble like the idolaters, since they imagine they'll be heard for their many words. Don't be like them, because your Father knows the things you need before you ask Him. Therefore, you should pray like this. Our Father in heaven, your name be honored as holy. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive people their wrongdoing, your heavenly Father will forgive you as well. But if you don't forgive people, your heavenly Father will not forgive your wrongdoing. Whenever you fast, don't be sad-faced like the hypocrites, for they make their faces unattractive, so their fasting is obvious to people. I assure you, they've got their reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that you don't show your fasting to people, but to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Matthew 7, verse 7 says, keep asking, and it will be given to you. Keep searching, and you will find. Keep knocking, and the door will be open to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who searches finds, and the one who knocks, the door will be opened. What man among you, if his son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks him for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good things to those who ask him? Therefore, whatever you want others to do for you, do also the same for them. This is the law and the prophets. Jesus takes on spiritual practices one by one. Let's take them on. Number one, Jesus takes on the spiritual practice of giving. He follows the same formula every time. And here is what he does. In the area of giving, he states the spiritual practice, giving. Actually, in the old translations, it says almsgiving. In newer translations, giving to the poor. This was not the regular offering in Israel. This was the special offering in Israel, the special offering to the poor. And so oftentimes, we can feel too good about ourselves by helping other people. That's not just us. That's been people throughout time. And so this special giving to the poor was the observance. Jesus gives a prohibition. And the prohibition is other people shouldn't know what you're giving. That this should not be an act of self-promotion. Oh, look how charitable I am. Oh, look how altruistic and generous I am. Jesus says, if that's what you do, you can do it. But your intent is wrong. By the way, talking about heart level religion, if I really have a heart for the poor, my motivation is to help the poor, not promote myself. So if I want to help the poor, help the poor. But no need for self-promotion. If your heart is for them, you look have already looked past yourself to their need, and you want to meet their need, and quite frankly, want to be as discreet as possible in the process of meeting their need. No need to heap shame upon shame on folks who already don't have enough, because you need to be seen as the one who did it. Jesus says there's plenty of spiritual practices happening like that. But notice, the Bible does not promote, as we think, we have this word called altruism, which means we give because we just have empathy for others. And I think that's important. But the Christian gives not just for altruism. The Christian gives because he knows God's watching. And that the way we live our lives will actually be condemnation on Judgment Day or reward on Judgment Day. The Christian is actually aware of that, because Jesus says the person who gives charitably but wants to be seen, he says they've got it. Whatever accolade, whatever plaque they received, whatever diploma someone gave them, whatever faceplate somebody put on something, well, they got it. That's all they're going to get. They're going to get nothing from me. But the one who does it and does it to not be seen, that their right hand doesn't know what their left hand's doing, God says, I'll reward that person. By the way, if I give and don't have to be seen because I know God sees and I want to really help the person in front of me, the spiritual discipline is working. You track with this? If you do it the other way, not working. Jesus points this out. Jesus goes to another spiritual discipline, fasting. This is at the latter part of the text. Again, the same exact formula, the observance, fasting. In Old Testament Israel, and by the time of Jesus' day, they fast twice a week. Actually, the Pharisee says, we fast twice a week. That was like their platitude. By the way, it's good to fast. Nothing wrong with fasting. You ought to fast from time to time. I don't even think it a bad idea to maybe say I need to fast at least once a month just to make sure that we can lay down the fork and get in the closet. It's a very important activity. And yet, the prohibition. Fasting had become a place of self-promotion. How do we do this? What sinful people we are. And so the Pharisees would put their sad faces on, feel sorry for me, I'm really hungry, I'm doing it for God. No, you're not, you're doing it for you. Let's just call it out. This is not piety, this is arrogance. And Jesus says, it's not working. And quite frankly, if your purpose in fasting is to convince other people around you that you're spiritual and you're really taking one for the team, Jesus says, well, there it is. Whatever people think about you because of their spiritual practice, then you got all that you're going to get. But Jesus says, if you fast and you do so secretly, you don't let everybody know you're fasting, you go, oh, I'm hungry. No, you clean up and you look as normal as you can normally look. And you're fasting not to applaud, let anybody else even know about it, but you're fasting because even when your stomach is hungry, you're going through the day saying, God, I sense my physical need, and in this moment, may I draw closer to you. And nobody needs to know about it but God. And Jesus says, your Father who is in secret will reward you because he sees you in secret. Jesus then hits the big one, prayer. Now you might think that praying, we got this. I just know a lot of people think they don't need to learn how to pray. Most people just, they like, I need to learn the Bible. That's why they, you know, they say, well, I'll learn the Bible, but praying, I think I figured that one out. I already know how to do it. I don't need instruction. It's one thing. You know, could you imagine turning in your prayers to God and God editing them, going, no, no, don't say that. No, no, that's no, unnecessary. No, 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 I'm not like that at all. I don't know who you're talking to. Do we think like this? Jesus corrects praying. First of all, he does the normal one. He will deal with people who pray to be seen. Again, you can give to be seen, you can fast to be seen, you can pray to be seen. And so honestly, there always ought to be a caution. Anytime we pray publicly, then we ought to just be aware, am I talking to God or am I talking to the people in front of me? And so there ought to be a caution. Doesn't mean that you cannot pray publicly at all. I don't think there's a total prohibition. But if you're praying for other people to think, man, he's really spiritual, if that's your intent, it's not working. That's not the point of praying. You ought to pray to God to bring other people along in your prayer. Jesus says, by the way, your private praying should always exceed your public praying. If the only times you pray are perfunctory prayers at meals or a prayer here or there at needed occasions, no time in the closet, no time in prayer, then I can just tell you, I don't know what your public prayer is, but if there's not a substantial amount of private prayer to back it up, then probably your public prayer is incorrect. And so Jesus says all disciples ought to have plenty of secret time in prayer. That ought to happen. And that any public prayer is a mere overflow of private prayer. But that's not the only issue. Jesus says, okay, we got to be careful. Jesus says we don't need babblings either. Now, I will just say, babblings, what Jesus says, don't think, he says they think they'll be heard for their many words. The problem with that type of praying is it misunderstands God. You know, some people have this idea, You know, it's one thing to realize that the God to whom we pray needs nothing from us. We have no bartering ability. We cannot make a deal. You don't make deals with God who says, I need nothing. So you cannot get in there and barter. Nor can you get in the place of prayer and manipulate God, twist his arm. Look, I'm going to say this again, God. Now, this time you're going to listen to me. Jesus says, wait a minute. No. The God that we pray to needs nothing, and you can't twist his arm. The good news is he's a loving heavenly Father who wants to give good gifts to his children. But don't be coming in prayer like you're going to make a deal with God, or you're going to twist God's arm. God won't be impressed. I'll just say this. Maybe it's years ago, I can't remember. My times are off sometimes. I remember I took a Wednesday night, several Wednesday nights, and all I did with the group, with the Wednesday night prayer group, was we looked at biblical prayers, primarily the prayers in the New Testament. And I simply asked myself a question. What are the priorities of prayer in this prayer contained in the Bible? Like, what is on the Apostle Paul's mind when he prays? And really study the prayer. You track with this? To our surprise, the Bible's praying sounded very different than our praying. That the eyes of their heart may be opened, and that they may know what is the height and the depth and the love of God which is found in Christ Jesus. These are the prayers. And I thought, well, now, that isn't exactly how I go at it. And so then we would articulately write down the priorities, and then we wouldn't pray the prayer, the exact prayer, you understand? We would say, now we're going to pray a prayer that will be our own. It will be our own, but it's going to be in these priorities. You track with that? Now, I'm not making a case, so don't. I'm still a card-carrying Baptist. But it is a little bit of a shame that we've taken the prayer books of the church and the Baptist church and thrown them in the back. Because what did the prayer books, again, of the church, what have they become? They have become rote things that people don't pay attention to when they read. That's bad. They're good, however, because what are they doing? Cutting some new lines of thought in prayer. Saying, look, pray like this on this occasion. Think about this on this occasion. Change it up. Don't just pray for the seven greatest needs that you know at this particular moment, which, quite frankly, is most of our praying. And sometimes we get in there and twist God's arm and say, look, you got to do something. And Jesus says, I don't know what that is. That's not Christian praying. So then he gives us the famous Lord's Prayer. The Lord's Prayer can be repeated verbatim. Almost did it today. Repeated it verbatim. Then I thought, no, not going to repeat it verbatim. Because the point is not to repeat it verbatim, although you should memorize the Lord's Prayer. I know you're not in Awanas where they memorize Scripture, but for crying out loud, memorize the Lord's Prayer. I mean, you know, just commit it to memory. If you don't know it, get on it. Like this is your assignment for today. Memorize the Lord's Prayer. Like before the day is over, and I don't care how old and dilapidated your brain is, you can do it. It should already be in you. But the point of the Lord's Prayer is it to be our framework, that these are the type of priorities that we pray. And I'm just going to quickly go through the lines of the Lord's Prayer, and then I'm going to allow us to have a time of prayer at the end of our service. All right, so just listen carefully. First of all, the first line in the Lord's Prayer is, Our Father in heaven, your name be honored as holy. Or the old translations say, hallowed be. The problem is, I'm not sure most people know what hallowed be means. It means your name be honored as holy. Now notice, The first thing we do when we come to the place of prayer is that we calibrate our vision of God. If we don't know who God is, we certainly don't know how to talk to Him. And the number one name for God that Jesus says use when you talk to God is Father. That's the name. The Aramaic translation of Father, Abba. It's almost like James, my son, has about 7 words now. Okay? He can use them at will. But these are the easy ones. In the first century, so was Abba. That was the easy one. It was when a child only had a few words, he had that one, Dad, Abba. And so when we start praying, God is not remote, He is not distant, He's there. When we only have basic impulses to start our praying, it comes in at the bottom shelf. And then if you notice, the prayer flexes. You have Father, which is so bottom shelf, and then right after that, Jesus says, the God who approaches us as Father, Abba, bottom shelf, is the one whose name cannot even be uttered. The divine name. Your name. Why don't they say what the name is? You don't say the name. It's too sacred. When Moses says, Who shall I say send me? The I Am. The divine name. Yahweh. The creator of heaven and earth. The one who thunders off of Sinai. That one. This is what we call both immanence, God here with us. Transcendence, God greater than us. Right there at the beginning. So at the same moment you come to God as a small child uttering Abba, and at the same time you enter into the majestic throne room of the Maker of heaven and earth, upon which, when you stand in front of Him, remove your shoes. For where you stand is holy ground. And they both happen in the introduction. And sometimes we have to just sit there in the moment and absorb this God who has now come to us and the God to which we approach. Maybe the first call is don't go barging in. Maybe sit there and say, God, may I see you. May you be as close to me as a father, but as hallowed, as holy as the God that you are. And if you get God in view, then you don't come in and say, oh yes, God, I've got 17 things I would like to. You get God in view, your kingdom come. Your will be done. It may be done right now. May it not be done in the heavenlies. May the heavenly realities be done on earth. A brief commercial for my Sunday night talk. The main message of John the Baptist, the main message of Jesus, the kingdom of God. Most Christians kind of fuzzy on that. It's a big concept. Here it is in a small summary. God's full rulership over His world that is not fully seen, but God's full rulership can be seen in you. And through you, His will can be done. And His will can be done now. And one day, we pray for His kingdom to come in us. We pray for His kingdom to come at Liberty Baptist. And one day, the curtain will be opened. God Himself will come. And I always hear, when I hear this, the final lines of Handel's Messiah, the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Jesus says, my will, not your will, informs your praying. And then we move. After we've calibrated ourselves to God and his will and his kingdom, we ask for today. Give us today our daily bread. By the way, just want to note one thing. Do you know it doesn't say, give me today my daily bread? You notice that? Give me today my daily bread. Give us today our daily bread. First of all, the Lord's Prayer desires for us to see God's provision to all people, and especially to fellow Christians. So our prayer is for my daily bread, but for our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. And then further, this is probably the reason Christians pray at meals. Because Jesus told us to pray, give us this day our daily bread. When we sit down for a meal, we don't ask for the bread. We thank God for the bread given. And we're saying, from your gracious hand, you have provided the provision for this moment. This is not so much the ask, but the thankfulness for that which has already been provided. For your Heavenly Father knows what you need before you ask it. I just wonder how much thankfulness I have and you have when we have so much that every good thing, you say, from your hand, God, from your hand, God, from your hand, daily bread today. And it also should focus us, I'll confess. I say, God, give me today my daily bread and next week's, if you wouldn't mind. You know, I like to have a little bread back, you know, if we have a few short days. But that on some level, that stewardship. Some level, that stewardship. And on some level, that self-righteousness. Self-sufficiency. There are no few sharp words for Jesus for people who trust in their riches. God, I don't need your daily bread today. I've got my own in the barn. Don't worry about it. And that, if that mindset creeps into our thinking, no, today what is given from the hand of God. Because everything you have can go away as fast as you got it. Oh, then it heats up. The communal dimension, right? We're asking for our daily bread, but as we ask for our daily bread, we ought to spot people around us who don't have it, and maybe God uses us for the conduit to give it. And then this one, the big one. And forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. One of the things that we ought to do in prayer now is full confession. And by the way, you say, "Ooh, I need to go confess in the closet." Well, no, this is one of the places where you can confess your sins one to another. Forgive us our debts. Like in our prayer closet, and then with a Christian friend, we ought to keep aware. By the way, this is the only way we know if it's working inside, an inside-out change, is if we actually know, I used to think and feel this way, and now I don't. I confessed it and I died to it, and God's power through me changed me. It's the only way we know. And so there ought to be serious confession. Again, I'm not a Roman Catholic. Never will be. But the idea of the confessional, although it got very distorted, I'm not sure that Baptists even have that idea. I'm not telling anybody my sins. Well, I hope you're telling God. Because you have debts that need to be forgiven. Like, there ought to be this place somewhere. Oh, and then, by the way, you're in the midst of confession. You're in the midst of admitting your need. What about the other person who's wounded you? None of us get out of life without some wounds. None of us. Unforgiveness turns to bitterness. Bitterness turns to hate. Hate turns to revenge. So forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. My sincere is, you will never from your heart forgive someone in your own strength. The Holy Spirit of God must move in your heart to grant real forgiveness. And so this ought to be, I mean, as you pray, you ought to say, God, I'm confessing my sin. And God says, well, what about this person who's offended you? And then you must grant forgiveness. But it requires God's help. And then this, by the way, let me just point out one other facet. Some of the things Jesus says we like to shuffle to the side. By the way, listen to this. A heart that is set on revenge, which we looked at last week, is totally inconsistent with a disciple of Jesus. If all you want to do is get even, get revenge, pay back, may I just say Jesus will look at you. If you are a revenge-filled person, and Jesus, with his eyes of holiness, will look at you and say, if you are that vengeful, have you ever really been forgiven? Because he says, if you forgive people their wrongdoing, your heavenly Father will forgive you as well. But if you don't forgive people, your Father will not forgive your wrongdoing. I'm not saying you struggle to forgive. I'm saying if there's no desire for forgiveness, if there's just revenge and hate, then maybe you need to meet the God who really has forgiven you. Now that's a gut check. But Jesus is the one who throws it and says, be aware. And then lastly, and do not bring us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. This is a tough section. Even the Pope recently said we ought to change this line. I don't often agree with the Pope, but I kind of agree with him on this. The idea, God, by the way, God doesn't tempt people. The Bible says, when you're tempted, James says, don't say I'm being tempted by God. I'm not trying to give you a quick Greek lesson, but the same Greek word can be translated tempt or test based upon context. Tempt or test. So the idea here is, while Satan tempts, God does allow test. And God allows tests for all of us. And so the idea is, God, could we miss the test? That would be excellent. Do not bring me into the time of the test. Like, I would like not to be thrown into the test. But if I do find myself in the test, in the crucible of difficulty, deliver me from the evil one. May I pass the test and not be drawn into temptation. That's the idea. By the way, just FYI, spiritual readiness for spiritual warfare should be part of what we do. I cannot help but hear in this moment the words of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, where he looks at his disciples and says, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. Only God knows what tomorrow will hold for us. And tomorrow, today, you may be thrown in the crucible of a situation. It might be today that Satan, as he desired for Simon Peter, to sift you like wheat. That could be today. That could be this afternoon. That could be tonight. That could be tomorrow. And you just say, God, you may not keep me from it, but God, may I be ready so you can keep me through it. And I just wonder, with so many people blowing out in the Christian faith, succumbing to temptation, I cannot believe that this prayer is being prayed. Because the God, by the way, full confession, full repentance, full spiritual readiness, you're ready then for your day. And then the last thing Jesus says, which I read in Matthew 7, 7 through 11. You know the problem with praying? We don't do it faithfully. Jesus says, keep asking. Keep seeking. Keep knocking. Everyone who asks will receive. Everyone who seeks will find. Everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. And prayer is our very life blood, our life breath. And the sad reality is, I think if we do prayer inventories, we're good, and then we're not so good. Listen, this is one of the few Sundays I'm not really worried about time. I know what time it is. We're going to have a little... Let me first say this. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. May I say, God is a loving Heavenly Father who wants to forgive you. If you are here today and you say, I want God's forgiveness, listen carefully. You need to find me. I'll show you how you receive God's forgiveness. But right now we're going to go through just a little season of prayer. I can't end the sermon. I can't end this section on the Sermon on the Mount without giving you an opportunity to pray. And if you're a few minutes late for Sunday school class, I'm sorry. But can we end this and not now try to do it? And so, this is the way it's going to go. Sandra's going to go to the piano, which she's doing right now. And then, listen carefully, I'm going to lead you in prayer. And basically what's going to happen, you're going to pray silently, and I'm just going to state the lines of the Lord's Prayer, and I want you to offer up your own prayers at those moments. You understand this? And then, at the conclusion of our service today, our final prayer, the choir is going to be making their movement while we're doing our final prayer, our prayer exercise, and they're going to sing the Lord's Prayer, which will be our final benediction. When they're done, our service is over. Let's bow your heads, close your eyes. This is what we want to do to get started. Let's get God in view. Right there where you are, get a full picture of God, the loving Heavenly Father. And right there, also get a full picture, as close as you can, of God in all of His holiness, in all of His radiance, in all of His majesty, and just sit there before Him. Sit there in the presence of God, just thank Him for being a kind Father. As you sit there before the Lord, be overwhelmed by His majesty. And then as you get a vision of Him, maybe you ought to say from your heart to God's heart, say the words to Him now that you've got Him in view. Say, God, Your kingdom come, Your will be done in me, on earth. And right there, allow God to shift and change priorities. As you sit there, you can look to God, the loving Heavenly Father, and say, give us this day our daily bread. Why not right there thank Him for His overabundance of provision for us? Now enter into a time of confession. Forgive us our debts and call them out. Call out your sins. Call out your missed discipleship. Call out your motives. And say, God, thank you that you love me and forgive me even for this. Now show God the wound. God, show God the place where hurt remains and where forgiveness is needed. And hold the offender up before the Lord and say, God, help me to forgive this one. And lastly, let's ask God for spiritual readiness. You can even ask the Lord right now, God, would you be so gracious as to give me smooth days? God, I do not desire a time of testing. And yet, as you sit there before the Lord, only God knows what's on the horizon for any of us. And so may at this moment we ask God for spiritual readiness. That if there is an attack, we'll be able to stand.
Into temptation.